NHK World. Tsukiji Market, right on the waterfront in Tokyo, is the most famous fish market in Japan. Alongside fish from Japanese waters, there is seafood from all around the world. Every day, almost 2 billion yen's worth of seafood is sold here. For half a century, it's been the world's largest fish market. The name Tsukiji is synonymous with seafood, and the market draws numerous visitors, both young and old, including many people from other countries. The commercial buyers have a sharp eye for the freshest, most delicious seafood. The high standards of Japanese cuisine are in large part due to their meticulous commitment to quality. Japan is an island nation surrounded by fertile ocean, and since ancient times, fish has been a staple of the diet. And most of the fish eaten in the Tokyo area passes through this market. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we explore Tsukiji, the market that feeds 40 million people in the Tokyo area and beyond.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today I'm standing in Tsukiji Fish Market in central Tokyo. Certainly one of the largest fish markets, or one of the largest markets in the world, certainly the biggest I've ever seen. We're actually only a short distance from the high-class department stores of Ginza. It's only a short walk away, but you really feel like you're in a completely different world here. There are trucks, large and small, going up and down all the time, carts, and in fact these little motorized carts like this one. They're called turret trucks, and again, these are up and down the whole time. You have to be very careful you don't step in front of one. The Japanese love fish, they love all kinds of seafood, and this Tsukiji market is what makes the whole thing possible. As you walk around here, you really get a feel for how essential seafood is to the diet and culture of Japan. And today we're going to take an in-depth tour of Tsukiji market.
Tsukiji is a wholesale market dealing in both seafood and farming produce. It occupies an area of 230,000 square meters. Every day, 2,100 tons of fish are delivered to the market from Japan and around the world. Over the course of a year, 500 billion yen's worth of seafood is sold here. That's about six times the business done at New York City's famous Fulton Market. There are 14,000 people working in the market, and every day some 28,000 customers arrive to buy their produce. From early in the morning, Tsukiji is a hive of activity. The key players in the market's business are the fish wholesalers, who operate around 800 stalls inside the market. At Tsukiji, the seafood is delivered direct from the fishing ports, and the market wholesalers bid for it in auction. Having bought the fish, the wholesalers then sell it on to retailers and restaurant buyers who come in person to the market. To see how Tsukiji market works, let's look at the way tuna is traded. At 9 o'clock in the evening, the tuna from around the globe starts to arrive. About 3,000 tuna are sold here every day. More than 75% of the tuna that passes through Tsukiji is frozen, caught in distant oceans, such as off the coast of Ireland or near the Maldives. fresh tuna caught in the seas around Japan are packed individually in wooden boxes. This premium price specimen, which weighs 130 kilograms, will sell for at least 1.5 million yen. Tuna is one of the most popular kinds of fish in sushi restaurants. At 4:30 a.m., a crowd of buyers gathers inside the tuna auction hall. These are the market wholesalers. The tuna have been laid out in rows, and before the auction begins, the buyers inspect the fish. They examine each one closely to determine the quality of its flesh. Because tuna and other fish are often eaten raw in Japan, it's essential that they are of the highest quality. Each of the tuna has had its tail chopped off. By inspecting the flesh that is revealed, the buyers can get a good idea of the overall quality. The buyers take a piece of the flesh and roll it between their fingers. Based on the oiliness and the color, they can ascertain the fat content, which determines how good it will taste. They also check other aspects, such as the texture of the fish and the curve of its belly. To understand the quality of a tuna before it is sliced open is a great skill. It takes at least 10 years of experience to be able to judge a tuna this way. At 5:30 a.m. the auction begins. The wholesalers bid for the individual fish they have inspected and have set their eyes on. It takes just 5 seconds to auction each tuna. For the wholesalers, their business that day depends on what happens in those 5 seconds. More than 20 billion yen changes hands per year inside this auction room. The buyers convey their bids using special finger gestures called teyari, which stand for numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Using these signs, bidders try to land the tuna they are after. Out on the auction floor, it's a battle of wits and skill among these seasoned pros. Once a buyer is successful, the tuna is loaded onto a cart and rushed to the wholesaler's market stall so that it can be sold while it's as fresh as possible. The next step is to cut the fish up into the size of portions that the customers require. At 7 a.m. the customers start to arrive. Many of them are from fish shops or restaurants. The price for each transaction is decided between the market wholesalers and their customers. It's a form of haggling. There are no written prices posted. To ensure they get the best cuts of tuna for the best price, the retail customers also need to have a keen eye for quality. Meanwhile, the wholesalers strive to win the trust of their demanding customers by stocking better quality tuna than other vendors. Behind the business scenes at Tsukiji, the fish market professionals are locked in a series of commercial duels. It is their hard work that underpins Japan's delectable seafood cuisine.
Actually, inside the market area here, there are many small restaurants that cater to the market workers, the wholesalers, their customers as well, and they're even open to the general public. And as you can probably see, there are long queues that form here from very early in the morning because everybody knows that the fish is just going to be really, really good. And actually, I'm going to go in and try some sushi at one of these restaurants right here.
Yeah, こちらが当店のお任せのおにぎりでございます。
That looks amazing. And since I came out today without any breakfast, I'm going to get stuck right into this. So, so.
It is really fresh, as I expected, of course. Hold on a minute.
You have to know when a certain fish is in season and when is the best time of the year to eat it. Where a fish comes from is also important. Another thing is finding a reliable wholesaler and developing a relationship. These are the three things that matter most.
Many people think that all kinds of fish need to be eaten immediately after they're caught, if they're raw, or as soon as possible. It's actually not the case. Some kinds of fish, that's absolutely true, but there are other kinds where they actually taste a little better if they're left for a day.
This bluefin tuna here is from Wakayama Prefecture, and it really becomes more delicious if you let it sit for a day.
The serving of raw fish, and to a certain extent the eating of it as well, requires some sensitivity. We're going to take a look now at Japan's long-lasting love affair with fish and how Tsukiji developed to its current state of importance.
Japan is an island country surrounded by ocean, washed by some of the world's most fertile currents. And after Buddhism was introduced to Japan, eating meat was officially forbidden for some 1200 years. These are the two main reasons why seafood has played such an extremely important role in the Japanese diet and culture. Around 1,000 years ago, the aristocrats of the Heian court in Kyoto dined on fish that was brought from around the country. This fish would be served grilled or preserved in vinegar and salt. By the 13th and 14th centuries, trade routes had developed that made it possible for fish to be transported more easily. Rice and fish became the pillars of the Japanese diet. Besides their importance as food, fish were often used to make offerings to the gods. One fish that is commonly served on festive occasions and also as a sacred offering is sea bream. Other fish offered to the gods include bonito and tuna. Fish, like rice, was a food imbued with special significance for the Japanese. The Edo period began about 400 years ago. Over the next 2.5 centuries, people began to eat more and more fish. When the first Tokugawa shogun, Ieyasu, set up his government in Edo, fishermen from Osaka were brought to the new city. They were given special rights to catch seafood from the bay to supply the tables of the shogun and his court. A major fish market grew up on the waterside in the city's Nihonbashi district. A stone commemorative plaque has been erected to mark the spot where the market used to stand. Besides supplying the shogun's castle, the fishermen also sold their catch at the Nihonbashi market. Merchants called Tonya operated shops around the market, and those with special licenses from the shogun's government began to handle large quantities of fish from all around the country. As the city grew, the market went from strength to strength. Every morning it handled transactions worth 1,000 ryo, equivalent to 100 million yen in today's money. There was so much seafood on offer that a popular saying was coined, comparing Nihonbashi with the mythical Dragon King's Palace at the bottom of the ocean. Thanks to the market and its system of wholesalers, a huge volume and variety of seafood became available, providing ordinary city people with all the fresh fish they needed. The start of the Meiji era in 1868 saw Japan embrace Western culture and values. the taboo against meat eating was formally lifted. For the first time in 1200 years, Japanese people were free to eat meat. But fish kept its central place in Japanese cuisine. And as the 20th century dawned, fish consumption continued to grow. Then, in September 1923, Tokyo was devastated by a massive earthquake. The Nihonbashi fish market burned to the ground, bringing an end to its long history. A new market had to be built, and finally in 1935, it opened in the waterfront district of Tsukiji. It had been hotly anticipated and was soon thronged with visitors. Railway lines were laid into the market so that fresh fish could be delivered from other regions as well as directly from boats docked at the wharf. In the 70 years since then, Tsukiji has served a vital role in keeping fish on the tables of Tokyo and the surrounding area, in the process becoming the largest market in the world.
Right next to the fish market is a small Shinto shrine called Namioke Jinja. Namioke literally means to hold off the waves. The current building here was constructed in the 1930s, but the original shrine dates back to the 17th century, when work began to try to reclaim land in Tokyo Bay. Now, the work wasn't going well because the sea was so rough, but after they built the shrine, strangely enough, the sea calmed down and the work started to proceed much more smoothly. Now, if you come inside the shrine, there are some rather interesting stones over here on the left. These are, as it were, mini shrines dedicated to the spirits of the different kind of seafood that you see in the market. For example, this one is sushi. Next to it is shrimp. And there are more for things like monkfish and something else over in the background there. And to my surprise, there's even one of these for egg. The idea is that because you're taking the life of these things for people to eat, you offer thanks and appreciation in return. Ever since the market started operating here at Tsukiji, market workers have come to this shrine to pay their respects to the deities and to pray for protection as well. The idea of offering thanks for your food seems to me a very Japanese thing. Not only do you buy and sell product in the market next door, you offer your thanks here at the shrine at the same time. Tsukiji is also a magnet for foreign tourists. You'll find visitors here from all over the world. Hello, where are you from?
Japan.
You're just visiting here in Tokyo?
Yeah, we're visiting Japan.
3 weeks. What's your impression of this place?
I think it's amazing.
Yeah. I've never seen so much raw fish in my life.
I'm from the Caribbean, Dominica.
Okay, and you're just visiting here in Tokyo?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's your impression of this?
Well, when one expects a fish market, they expect not this. It's very clean. The
really?
Workers are very diligent. They're very focused.
Ah. Hi, where are you from?
Canada.
Just arrived in Tokyo?
Last night.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, yeah. Just last night.
Yeah.
You came down here first thing in the morning.
Yeah.
So obviously this was on your list of things to do.
Yeah, I'm a cook, so I had to come check it out.
You're a what, sir?
Cook.
Chef, oh, I see.
Chef kind of thing, yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Have you been to other fish markets, like in Canada? Or
in Canada, yeah. I grew up on the ocean, so, yeah.
How does this compare?
Doesn't compare at all. This is amazing, yeah. It really is amazing. Yeah.
Have you had any food yet?
No, we're in the process. We're in the process.
Have some breakfast.
Yeah, exactly.
This market has a long history, but these days there are a number of problems facing Tsukiji. Global fish stocks are on the decline, and the wholesale business is becoming tougher. On our next video, we look at some of the challenges facing the younger generation of wholesalers here.
Many of the wholesalers in Tsukiji are long-established operations set up over a century ago. Most are family-run businesses. As the owners age, and with fewer children to carry on the business, some of these wholesalers have been facing problems in recent years. If no successor can be found, the company will shut down and go out of business. This specialist tuna wholesaler has a history dating back 400 years, from the earliest days of the Nihonbashi market. It's the oldest of all the companies in Tsukiji. Through the centuries, it has always been family-run, passing from one generation to the next. Today it is operated by two brothers in their 30s, Takarai Yuki and his younger brother Masayoshi. Yuki is in charge of the frozen tuna business and sales. Masayoshi takes care of purchasing fresh tuna. The brothers took over the business from their father, Takarai Kiyoshi. He operated the company for 40 years, taking the lead in developing the tuna business. Around 10 years ago, Takarai was found to be suffering from heart disease and had to undergo emergency surgery on two occasions. This prompted him to hand over the business to his sons. Normally, it takes many years of closely watched apprenticeship to learn the art of evaluating tuna and other aspects of the trade. For the Takarai brothers, there was no time for that. The fact is that in the tuna business, the customers come to you because they know you. It's a question of personal trust. So, when I got sick, we started losing customers. At the same time, my sons were still considered too inexperienced. That's the way our business was regarded by the sushi chefs we deal with. Because the two brothers lacked expertise, they sometimes failed to buy up the best tuna at the auctions. This kind of mistake happened on many occasions. Moreover, their long-time customers each have their own particular preferences. Some want tuna with plenty of fat, others prefer a soft texture. To keep these customers happy, the sons needed to buy up the right specimens of tuna. A full-fledged market wholesaler has to be able to evaluate the tuna on his own. At times, the brothers had to learn from the more experienced operators. In recent years, Japanese cuisine has caught on around the world, especially sushi. Because demand for tuna is growing in many other countries, its price has soared, and it's now much harder to get hold of premium fish. At the same time, a wholesaler must meet the requirements of each customer. Each customer has his own preferences. There's much more to it than just buying good tuna. Getting the right tuna for each customer, that takes experience. On this day, the younger brother goes to visit a sushi restaurant in Setagaya Ward. The sushi chef is an old friend of Masayoshi's father. He has continued to buy his tuna from the Takarai company even since the sons took over, following their father's illness. There were times when he could not get exactly the right tuna. It was a lesson for the young brothers, just how hard it is to provide customers with the exact tuna they want. The tuna he has delivered this time seems to be acceptable. There was a period when those two really needed to learn a lot to be able to supply me. But with the support of their customers, hopefully they will gain the skills they need. Meanwhile, the older brother, Yuki, has been developing new areas of business. This upmarket Japanese restaurant opened recently. I've brought various samples of the kind of cuts you asked for. This is southern bluefin, the fatty belly. It looks good. I think this might work well as a dinner course. I hope you will consider it. Okay, I'll buy a small amount as a trial and see how it works out. The Takarai brothers spend a lot of time meeting directly with their customers so that they can get to know exactly what each of them requires. In February, their father Kiyoshi died of heart failure. He was 68. The two brothers no longer have their father to give them guidance and support. As tuna becomes scarcer and its price continues to climb, they are finding the business climate hard. Many tough battles lie ahead. The important thing is to learn from our failures and about the way things work. If the two of us can really spur each other along by doing that, then I think we'll be fine. As a new generation takes over in Tsukiji, there can be no letting up in the efforts to provide the finest seafood so that Japan's traditional culinary culture can continue into the future.
Business is still done face-to-face here at Tsukiji. It's those personal connections that count. They get passed down from generation to generation, along with the tricks of the trade. This market has survived all kinds of turbulence, natural disasters, war, economic ups and downs, and there's more change on the way as well. Because the infrastructure here is a little old and getting somewhat cramped as well, the whole market is due to be moved in 2012, just down Tokyo Bay to an area called Toyosu. That move is likely to have quite an impact on the traditions of the fish market, which began in Nihonbashi and then were passed on here to Tsukiji. In the past 60-odd years since the end of World War II, Japan's diet has changed dramatically from what was more or less completely fish-centered to a much more meat-oriented diet. Nevertheless, compared with a lot of other countries, Japan still has a voracious appetite for fish, and that is probably going to be sufficient to preserve the traditions of a waterfront fish market, despite the location change. Well, that's it for this week. I'll see you all again next time, hopefully in slightly quieter surroundings. Bye.
On the next edition of Begin Japanology, our subject is yoshoku, a long-established style of cooking that blends European recipes with a traditional Japanese touch.